Hello, I'm PBS 39 host Monica Evans. PBS 39 is partnering with the Allentown Art Museum to bring you, our viewers, a preview of their Power and Piety exhibit of Spanish colonial art. Instead of broadcasting from our Bethlehem studios, we're inside the Scheller Art Gallery inside the Allentown Art Museum in Allentown. Its newest exhibit, Power and Piety, features paintings, sculptures, silver pieces, furniture, and decorative devotional objects made in the Spanish and Portuguese colonies of the Americas from the late 17th century to the early 19th century. Elaine Milakis, the Vice President of Curatorial Affairs at the Allentown Art Museum, joins us to walk us through the exhibit and highlight some of the key pieces in the collection. Elaine, thank you so much for having us.
It's wonderful to have you here.
I appreciate it. Tell me this, what can viewers, visitors I should say, expect?
They can expect to see rare and exquisite objects with a deep and significant history in our world that are the result of unprecedented cross-cultural exchange.
Now, some of these pieces, I can imagine them in a church, a convent, or a monastery. I can't imagine some of these pieces in someone's home, but I also would imagine if you can afford to purchase one of these pieces or have them commissioned, you don't live in an ordinary home, correct?
Very true. The Spanish-American elite were some of the wealthiest people in the world at this time, and so they could afford to commission these incredibly beautiful gilded works of art that you see in the first section of our show. But religion was so incredibly important to people that even the most humble people did have works of religious devotion in their homes in order to aid them in their prayers.
So some of these pieces were probably in receiving areas, I would imagine, if they're huge, and others, you said, perhaps in someone's bedroom, the smaller pieces?
Correct. So large pieces like the Mexican tabernacle, that would have been in probably a reception room of some kind.
That is amazing. It's 8 feet long. Tell me about that piece.
So that piece is really the result of the exchange that happened after the Spanish conquered the Philippines. So if we look at that work of art, it's in a sense reminiscent of Asian textiles. If we look at the pattern of the flowers on the red background.
I can see that.
And so that would have been in the 1560s, the Spanish conquered the Philippines and then started this trade between the colonies in the Americas and the Philippines, which also opened the door to China and India as well.
Tell me about Our Lady of Mount Carmel. That's an oil on canvas piece, 1751 to 1809, by a Puerto Rican artist.
That is by Jose Campeche, who is probably the best known artist who worked in Puerto Rico in the late 18th and early 19th century. And he came from a family of artists. So this was common at the time in colonial Spanish America that the techniques would be passed down from generation to generation.
That's a beautiful piece. How about Christ's Child?
So that is a piece that is an ivory sculpture, and that was made in the 18th century. And after the Spanish explorers secured control of the Philippines in the 1560s, one or two Spanish trading ships would sail the round-trip voyage between New Spain and the Philippines every year. And they think that as much as a third of Mexican silver was actually exported to Manila at this time.
Wow.
And there it was traded for exotic spices and things like silk, porcelain, and ivory sculpture like this one.
And the Virgin Mary. Tell me about that piece.
Yes, so that piece is also the result of this trade, but the style of it suggests that it's more likely to have been made in Ceylon or Goa in India than in the Philippines.
Now, all of these pieces would have been in someone's home. They're incredibly striking.
Absolutely. These would have really made an impact when people visited the families.
Now, tell me about the tabernacle again. You mentioned that it would be in a area of the home where someone would see it immediately. How would it be lit so that it can be appreciated? Because there was no electricity then.
Exactly. So it would have been lit by candlelight, and you'll see that there are spots for candles to go in there, and they would have been in front of the mirrors that are throughout the piece.
That must have been beautiful to just see it illuminated
with
the mirrors.
You can just imagine.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And it looks like it can be closed.
Yes, so when it was not in use, it could be closed up and it would be kind of a box format. And then when you opened it, of course, you saw this incredibly stunning piece.
Wow. Tell me about the their heads on the bottom of that piece. What do you think that signifies?
The focal point of that piece is the Virgin, the Immaculate Conception, which refers to the purity of the Virgin Mary, Mother of Christ. And she is being supported by three cherubs, and she's also standing on a sickle moon. And below all of that is a dragon that signifies her ability to trample down evil.
There's another piece, and we'll talk about that in a minute, that has a dragon in it. I think it's Margaret of Antioch. I thought, wow, slay that dragon. That's a pretty impressive piece, but I will talk about that in a minute. Tell me this, when viewers walk into this exhibit, they may feel like they're in a church. There's a middle aisle through the exhibit. Why was the exhibit created with that footprint?
I worked with Steve Gamler, who is our preparator and who did this design for the show, and he came up with this idea of using a church floor plan. And that worked really well thematically with the exhibition because we do have these three sections, one of which is art for the church. And so this section that we're looking at right now is art for the church, and we've been able to make these little side chapels that the paintings go in, which is very much how they might have originally been seen.
Tell me about the pieces in the collection that would have been in a church. You have candlesticks. Tell me about them. They're from an unidentified Bolivian artist from the 18th century. They're beautiful.
Yes, and you can imagine them in a darkened space where the only light is candlelight, and the candlelight is reflecting off of the silver. So this would have really added to the contemplative nature of the space during the liturgy. And silver was an extremely important product of the American colonies. It was very significant in terms of the wealth of those colonies and supporting the Spanish Empire itself.
And there are a pair of chandeliers that are hanging up above us. They're very ornate, just beautiful, incredibly beautiful. Tell me how they would have been used.
So they would have been hanging from above like we have them here, and they would have had lit candles in them. And
again, these pieces would have been in a church.
These would have been in a church, yes, exactly.
And where are the chandeliers from?
These are also from Bolivia, made around 1700.
And it's the only source of light that these churches would have had.
Exactly. They would have had these chandeliers and also the candelabras, which would have been up on the altar. And you can imagine in the darkness that the points of light would have almost had this floating aspect to them.
It would. I can imagine it shimmering.
Exactly.
Throughout the church.
Yeah.
Wow, they're very stunning. And there's another silver piece from a Venezuelan artist that you wanted to highlight. Tell me about that piece.
Yes, so that is a sacrarium made by a silver smith named Domingo Tomas Nunez from about 1790. And that piece is a portable piece. So the priest would wear it around his neck on a chain, and it would be used to house the communion, and he would bring it to a person who could not be at the church, so oftentimes someone who was receiving their last rites.
Now let's talk about the furniture. They appear to be well preserved, but weathered with life, I'd like to say. I like the fringe floating on one of the seats, and it has a plush cushion on one that you can see is pretty well worn. What can visitors expect when they check out the furniture? Because they're pretty grand.
The chairs really demonstrate the evolution of style over the course of a century. So one of the chairs, the one in the center, is done in Spanish woodworking techniques, while the other one to the right is very much, you might recognize that it looks like a Chippendale chair.
It's beautiful.
It
looks like something you would see today.
Yes, and very much influenced by English traditions.
It's beautiful. And so you have three chairs in the collection,
mm-hmm.
all by different artists. Are they all from Venezuela?
Yes, they are.
One of them, you said it has like Spanish cedar. Which one is that?
It's the one that's in the center. And yes, that's one of the interesting things. Much of the art in this exhibition is very much related to European models, but then they were using techniques and materials that were unique to the Americas. And that's one example, the use of Spanish cedar that would have been native to South America and the Caribbean.
Now there's another piece that you wanted to mention, Our Lady of Light. It is a oil on canvas by Juan Pedro Lopez, 1765. Pretty impressive. Tell me about that piece.
This has a fascinating history. It's gone through metamorphosis throughout its lifetime. So this particular veneration to Our Lady of Light, at the same time that it just started becoming popular, it also was subject to efforts to ban it. So there was a lot of concern because Our Lady of Light depicted the Virgin as being able to rescue souls from damnation. And there was concern on the part of the church that this might mean that people would become lax in their morals and hope that later they would be saved. So at a certain point, about 5 years after this painting was made, there was a decree from the King of Spain banning this veneration. And the church stated that the figure of the soul being saved had to be painted over. And so they would paint over it and do something like leave the head that and have it look like a cherub. Rather than grasping the soul's wrist, she is then depicted grasping a scepter. And we can see that here. We can see both the scepter as well as the soul's wrist and body, because although this was painted over at one point, when they later did conservation on the piece, they revealed the figure on the left as well.
Wow, and now there's another Divine Shepherdess. That's an interesting piece.
Yes.
1828.
And this is by Joaquin de Sosa, another Venezuelan artist. This is a really fascinating piece. In the background, you can see the Archangel Michael rescuing a sheep from a ferocious wolf with his protective shield and sword. But one of the most unusual things about this painting is that there are two sheep that have human-like faces.
Hmm.
And the dedication on the back of the painting reveals that these are meant to be the two clerics who commissioned this work and who were asking for help from the Virgin and for guidance.
Wow, that's interesting. Tell me this, and I want people to understand this as well. This exhibit has some great fascinating pieces, but it's simply not for folks who are devout and religious. Elaborate on that.
The works are appreciable on an aesthetic level, and they're also just very significant in terms of the history of humanity. So while they are Christian works of art and would have originally been used for religious practice, they are now the relics of really the point in time where globalization as we know it started. And that is incredibly illuminating as we look at our world today.
So some great history here. Now let's talk about the frames. That's something that just jumps out at you. When you walk into the exhibit, there are gold frames, very intricate, from the carvings and curves of the frames to the raised accents that kind of pull you into the piece. Some of them were made in the late 17th century, so all of these had to be hand-carved. It's a lot of work. Why do you think the artist took such time with the framework?
Well, at this time, artists had a little bit of a different status than they do today, and artists were more in line with like carpenters. And they actually, in addition to painting the artworks, they would create these frames themselves. So they would do all that carving and gilding of the works And I think they did it because it was a way to acknowledge how important these works of art were to the people who owned them, and it was a way to really honor the significance.
They're stunning. There are pieces with, they're carved so intricately. I'm looking at a piece to my right that looks almost feather-like with swirls and flowers. There's a lot going on in a lot of these pieces, not only in the piece itself, but in the framing of this collection.
Absolutely, this really ornate style was quite popular at the time.
Now, there are devotional pieces in this collection. Please tell me about St. Margaret of Antioch. She has an interesting story.
She absolutely does.
She was not pressured into marriage.
They tried. They didn't get her to.
And this is 1769. She was a bit feisty, slaying dragons and Satan and all that jazz.
She was known for having been born into a pagan family and then converting to Christianity, and so dedicated to that she withstood torture and eventually was martyred for her faith. But one of the kind of bizarre tortures that is described about St. Margaret is that she was swallowed by Satan in the guise of a dragon, and that she had her cross with her, and that she used the cross to tear open the dragon's belly and emerge triumphant.
Now, in that piece, Satan is depicted as a dragon.
Yes.
Was that common? I noticed that in a couple of pieces. Explain that.
Yes, it was common for Satan to be depicted as a serpent-like creature or a dragon, and oftentimes saints like Saint Margaret or the Virgin, as we see in the Immaculate Conception, were shown trampling, and this was a symbolic way to show that they were overcoming evil,
yeah,
and it was inspirational.
Mm-hmm. You said it was very inspirational?
Yes, people would have these on their walls because it gave them strength to look at these examples.
Now let's talk about some of these devotional pieces that you have. There is another from the 18th century. It's a unidentified artist from Brazil. And again, the wood is very interesting and the glasswork. Tell me about that.
So this is a La Pinha oratory, and this was a very unusual type of domestic altarpiece that was characteristic of southern Brazil. So this was a new format that came to be in the Spanish colonies. Didn't exist before. And this piece, it's called a La Pinha oratory, referring to the caves or lapis of the Brazilian region of Minas Gerais. And that region is where the calcite stone to make the little figurines that are in the oratory were extracted.
Now, as I'm looking around the gallery, I notice that some of the pieces are encased and others are not. I'm assuming it's just to protect certain pieces?
That's correct, yes. These are fragile pieces that have survived several centuries now, and they have to be protected, of course, from any physical contact. And the pieces originally, if the owner had enough money, they would have protected them with a pane of glass to keep smoke and insects away, that kind of thing. So this is kind of a continuation of that, but it's a museum practice that just keeps them preserved for the future.
And many of them are not encased. And when people see art, they are inclined to touch.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that is truly a no-no. But I'm sure you have security and others here reminding people to look at it. And I can see signs on some of the pieces that say, don't touch. But you would echo that, I'm sure.
Of course, yeah. I mean, that is something that is different from when the paintings were originally owned by an individual. So some of the smaller pieces that people would have used for a personal devotion, they may have touched those pieces.
Certainly.
To feel a closeness. But that's something that we ask that you don't do today.
Just look from a distance.
Enjoy with your eyes.
Oh, I like that. Enjoy with your eyes. I like that. Now, our cameras captured the exhibit when it arrived in huge crates and it being unloaded and installed. It looks like a painstaking process with everyone working in sync to uncrate the collection and get it museum ready. Tell me this, when the Allentown Art Museum secured this collection, how long did it take for you and your colleagues to decide on placement? Because it takes some planning. I don't think people realize that there are tactics that go into putting the exhibit together. You have to design the space, put up walls, decide on the color to paint the space to give the artwork the best framework so it can be appreciated. Also, the artwork has to be hung at a specific height to allow it to be displayed for its best optimal viewing. So tell me about that.
Absolutely. So you've noted a lot of the things that we consider when we're putting together an exhibition. So we really start when we know we're going to host a traveling exhibition with reviewing all the materials and kind of absorbing and becoming familiar with the work and thinking about which works we think are really key in terms of presenting them. We think about the concept of the exhibition and what's important to communicate, and then we think about how we can translate that into a design and a layout and the juxtaposition of the objects and how we can highlight certain objects through their placement in the galleries and ensure that people, you know, don't think about how we did what we did, but that they get the best experience they can.
Now tell me why you like this collection.
It's incredibly unique. This is an all part of one private collection. This is Narrow's collection. And their goal is to recognize and to have greater global recognition for the contributions of Latin Americans to world culture. So I think it's a really important exhibition, an important collection to share. It also stands out among shows of Spanish colonial art, which more often focus on works from Peru and Mexico. This is primarily works from the Caribbean and the mainland areas around the Caribbean, especially Venezuela. So these are works that our visitors will certainly not have seen before.
Tell me what your hope for this exhibit is.
My hope is that people will come in and really think about how this art signals what's to come in our contemporary world, and that they think about what, you know, how our world came to be the way it is in terms of this cross-cultural exchange and the way that people traveled the world and encountered one another, sometimes for the very first time. So there's a lot really to think about and consider.
Our time has come to a close. Elaine, thank you so much for giving our viewers a sneak peek into the Power and Piety exhibit. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Monica.
If you're intrigued by what you've seen, you can check out the exhibit in person Wednesday through Sunday until December 9th. The Allentown Art Museum is located at 31 North 5th Street in the heart of the Allentown Art District, and it offers a variety of collections and exhibits, as well as educational programs and public events. I'm Monica Evans, and for all of us at PBS 39, thanks for joining us.